I don't even have to check my numbers. Just wait for somebody else to say, I won. Yeah, the glare is killing me here.
Commercial to run.
Was he saying that?
All right.
Really?
Tonight, this evening, you have the chance to buy a dozen eggs from an organic farmer in our room. Presently, John Butts Messina. What is the name of your concern?
Hidden Treasures Farm.
From the Hidden Treasures Farm. He has his own chickens that lay his own, or their own eggs. And there they are, brown and yellow.
Radio chickens.
So great. So I will be taking a dozen, but there are two more dozen left.
Three more. There's a dozen.
Okay. All right. Great. So that was a commercial. And we'll return to the
regular schedule.
We'll get the kickback
after. Okay. Listen up. Alan. He's a member of our club. He's been a member for about a year now. Official title, Application Engineer for Tektronix, RF, right?
Application engineer.
Why don't you explain before you start who you are, what you are, how'd you get here, as what you have now.
Give him the mic.
Did they do the mic tickets?
Yes, one of the questions.
Yeah, you lost.
All right.
A Pete Olman, I think.
Just in a pocket here somewhere. So, thank you, Rich. So again, I'm Alan Wolke. I am a field application engineer, kind of specializing in RF for Tektronix. I've been working for Tech for about 12 years. Prior to that, I was a design engineer, test engineer, and application engineer with a real job. I went to a building and I worked in a lab and that type of thing, but now working out of a home office and out on the road all the time, I don't really call it a real job anymore because I have too much fun with it. But, so, been a ham radio operator since high school in the late 70s, and always been tinkering around with stuff, but never really dealt a whole lot with antique radios until the last couple of years. And, a little bit of a restoration of an old Drake 2B receiver, and which is kind of fun. But I think it's my third time here. I think we talked about meter movements. We talked about the basics of oscilloscopes and poking around the radios with oscilloscopes. And I guess today, let's talk a little bit about digging in on capacitors and what they are and that type of thing. So again, I've got a bunch of slides here, but really the key here is, you know, if you've got questions, ask them. If I know the answer, I'll tell you. If I don't know the answer, I'll lie to you. But no, I won't tell you.
Alan, why don't you also tell them about your channel, too, so that they know.
So up here on the slide, you can see I have a YouTube channel. It's just youtube.com/my call sign, W28W. It's an easy way to find it. I've got a little over 280 videos up on the channel. I do a video about once a month or so now. Got 87,000 subscribers on the channel and almost 11 million total views, so it's been pretty popular. Most of the videos deal with basic electronics, ham radio, test and measurement, troubleshooting, a little bit of repair. I did a couple of videos on the Drake 2B that I worked on. But it's a little bit of everything. Some really in-depth, you know, RF, you know, kind of engineering level stuff, and some really, really basic stuff. So there's a little bit of everything. And you can find an index file on the main page there to that you can download and look at, or just open up and look at to make it easy to find videos that you want. So just do a quick search on that that index file. So if you can't find something, shoot me an email. It's just my call sign at arl.net. Get you an email to me. And if I don't have a video on it, I'll make a note to do one at some point in the future. But if we've got something that might help you out, I'll point you to it. So, all right?
Great, thank you.
All right, so let's get started. So here's our agenda tonight. Let's talk a little bit about just an introduction. What is a capacitor? Very briefly, I know most of you guys will know what that is. And the various types and properties and various specifications you'll find on capacitors. Some of them are pretty obvious. Some of them are a little bit more like, well, what is it? What does dissipation factor mean? We'll talk about those types of things. Okay. We'll also then dig into the most common types that we come across: electrolytic caps, ceramic caps, you know, film caps, mica caps, things like that. The things that we find. And then we'll have the fun and actually go play on the oscilloscope. And we're going to do two things actually. One is show how to measure an unknown capacitor using an oscilloscope and actually a couple of basic parts, something you can throw together pretty easily. And then also how to measure, we'll talk about what ESR is, but then we'll talk about actually how to measure ESR, equivalent series resistance on capacitors. A pretty common failure mode with modern electronics, but I would imagine pretty much as well on some of the stuff that you guys work on as well. All right? So a little bit of intro to capacitors. Really, as you know, a capacitor is really nothing more than two conductive plates separated by an insulator. Really all a capacitor is. So from a DC standpoint, it's an open circuit. Okay. From an AC standpoint, we can move charge on and off this capacitor, and depending on how the circuit is using that property, it could be a lot of different applications. We'll talk about those applications. The insulator that is inside or between the plates of a capacitor is really the key to the properties of that capacitor. All the characteristics, the applications where it can be used, how we classify the capacitor, what's good about a capacitor, what's bad about a particular capacitor, all has to do with the properties of that dielectric material. Okay, so that's why you see a bunch of different types of dielectrics. We're going to talk about that. The dielectric constant is a property that kind of determines, it's this little epsilon here, determines what the capacitance value will be for a given plate area or surrounding area, overlapping area of these plates. So fundamentally it's going to determine, the dielectric constant determines the amount of capacitance for a given physical size of a capacitor and structure of a capacitor. But there's a lot of other characteristics that the dielectric is going to enter into here as well. So you don't really have to remember these equations. You're not designing capacitors unless you're building like a magnetic loop antenna. You want to design a particular capacitor to resonate it. You might want to start thinking about some of these equations. But as it releases it, Google it and find it, and you're good to go. Okay. So let's talk about some of the basic capacitor specifications, right? Now, the most common thing you come across is, well, what's the capacitance, right? Most things that we'll run across in terms of the radios, the things that we work on, anything ranging from even less than 1 picofarad to well over a farad sometimes. But most of what we're dealing with is picofarads, nanofarads, microfarads in terms of the size of the capacitors we're working on. And that's almost always printed on the capacitor itself. You also have a tolerance on that. That's usually not printed on that. The tolerance is really how much of a variation from the nominal value that's printed on the capacitor is the actual value of that capacitor. and that could apply either over a lifetime or just when you pull it out of the box, things like that. Some capacitors can have very, very tight tolerances, and we'll talk about those. Other capacitors have really, really poor tolerance, okay? And again, that's all kind of comes down to the dielectric type and things like that and how they're used, okay? Also, you'll see typically printed on the capacitor is the working voltage. And this is essentially the maximum voltage you can withstand when operating across the plates of the capacitor. And any more than that, you risk breaking down the capacitor. It doesn't become a capacitor anymore, it becomes a short circuit. Or a little flame emitter or something like that, depending on the capacitor you're dealing with. Okay. So those are the real basic specs that everybody knows about with capacitors. Okay. But there's more. Okay. So one is leakage. And leakage is really, well, we said we got an insulator between these two plates, but no insulator is perfect. Okay, so you can think of leakage almost as a very high value resistor between those plates that allows some very small amount of current to flow. Okay. Ideally, you'd get none. Some capacitors, as they age, the leakage gets worse. You know, our old foil wax capacitors that they're always changing out on radios. That's the thing that happens most often with those is the leakage gets bad because the paper goes acidic in them. Okay. But all capacitors have some amount of leakage. It's just a matter of how much. Okay. Now, there's an interesting one, soakage or dielectric absorption. Not something you hear about too much, but it's kind of an interesting thing. It's abbreviated DA. It's almost like a memory effect. Okay, and some capacitors have got this in a pretty bad way, and some don't. Like electrolytic capacitors are pretty bad in terms of soakage and dielectric absorption. And this little kind of equivalent circuit kind of describes a little bit about what can go on with that. And think about, there's my main capacitor, is a 1 microfarad electrolytic. The soakage is can almost be modeled by a very large value resistor and a smaller capacitor, essentially in parallel with the main tap. So, well, why do we care about that? Well, one of the things that's interesting is if you take an electrolytic capacitor out of your bin you've normally been putting into a radio, and put a 9-volt battery across it, leave it there for a few minutes, take it off, and then put your voltmeter across it, you should see pretty close to 9 volts, right? You're not going to drop very much. Then short the leads out of the capacitor for a minute or a few seconds, and then open it up. But you short them out, your voltmeter should go to zero. As soon as you take that short off, you're going to watch that voltage rise back up again. Okay, because of some of the charge that's stored in the dielectric. Okay, and that's what we call dielectric absorption or soakage. Okay, the longer you charge it, the longer that capacitor is being used, the more you'll kind of saturate that, but you will get that kind of soakage. And that can have some bad effects in some circuits, particularly if the capacitor is being used in a timing circuit or something like that. Okay. So, but it is kind of an interesting property, okay? Something you don't hear about too often, okay? Here's another one, self-resonant frequencies. So, no capacitor is ideal, right? So a capacitor is drawn this way, but in reality, there's usually some small amount of resistance either in the leads themselves or constructing the plates for the capacitor itself. We're going to talk about that in a moment because that's really what gives rise to ESR, equivalent series resistance. But there's also, because of the lead length and the construction of the capacitor, there is some parasitic inductance associated with those leads. So what happens if we have a series combination of an inductor and a capacitor? At some frequency, it's going to resonate. Okay. So as frequency goes up, right, say at relatively low frequencies, the inductor will look like a wire. Okay, so the device looks like a capacitor. So the impedance or the capacitive reactance goes down as the frequency goes up, right? Everything works the way it should. But at some point, that inductive reactance is going to start to matter. And all of a sudden, the capacitor turns around, and instead of looking like a capacitor, it looks like an inductor. It says a capacitor, but it looks like an inductor, okay? And so you essentially can get curves that kind of look like this, where here's a 1,000 picofarad capacitor, at various frequencies, but at some frequency, this thing turns around and starts looking inductive. Okay, and you'll notice that the larger value capacitors have a lower self-resonant frequency. Why is that? Well, let's say all of the capacitors had the same amount of inductance, right? Well, it's really the product of the inductance of the capacitance that gives rise to where that resonant frequency is, right? So the square root of that, but it's still the product of them, okay? So for a given value of inductance, a larger capacitor will resonate at a lower frequency. So now why does this matter? Well, let's say I'm building a circuit, or I've got a power supply circuit that's feeding a circuit that's got maybe a microcontroller, or I got something going on like that. Is that a bad word to say right here? I don't know. But so you might have a mix of high frequency things going on in your circuit, low frequency things going on in your circuit, and want your power supply filter to accommodate all of that. So this is where you might use a larger electrolytic capacitor to handle the bulk filtering for low frequency things. Those larger capacitors might start looking inductive at the higher frequencies, where there might be noise from a switching power supply or a digital line or something like that. So you might put in parallel with that a smaller, maybe ceramic capacitor in parallel with the electrolytic to get more broadband filter. Okay, so that's why you see sometimes a lot of extra capacitors on a board, especially if you're looking at a PC or a modern piece of electronics. You don't just have one big honking power supply cap. You got a bunch of others because you've got to get this good broadband coverage of filter. And that's one reason why you might do that. Okay, because of the self-resonant property of capacitors. So some more properties. This is the scary one here, because it's all these weird terms. Okay, we've got ESR for equivalent series resistance. We also have this one called loss tangent, or dissipation factor, or quality factor. Okay. Now all of these things are just different names for the same phenomenon, for the most part. Okay. So remember, we talked about a capacitor having essentially, you can almost model it as having a resistor in series with the capacitor. It really is kind of resistance associated with the plates and the structure of the capacitor, but you can model it kind of as this series combination. And if we looked at and plotted the complex impedance, I won't go too far into this, but look as far as the complex impedance, and when you look at it in a complex space, the real axis is the resistance, the axis going down is the capacitive reactance. Now, if the capacitor was ideal, we could basically plot the capacitive reactance as a function of frequency, and that would be it. But the reality is we have some series resistance, so the overall impedance of this structure is going to not be perfectly capacitive. It's not going to be perfectly resistive, obviously. It's going to be some combination in between. Okay. So we get this, give rise to this thing called a phase angle here. But all of these things are all related. It's all measures of the same exact thing. Okay? The ESR is literally just that equivalent resistor value. Okay? But now if we take a look and kind of consider how this all enters into it and look at the ratio of ESR to the capacitive reactance, ideally we want that ratio to be, we want this to be zero, so everything's capacitive. The larger this gets with respect to the capacitive reactance, the worse that capacitor behaves. And there's a couple of ways of defining that. One is just by the ESR value. One is a little bit of trigonometry where we actually take the tangent of this angle as a value. Okay? And that's called the loss tangent. So we're just computing that angle. And actually the way you compute that is quite simple. The tangent of this angle is literally just the ESR divided by the capacitive reactance. Okay? And you want that loss tangent to be a very low number, right? We want this to be a very low number, and that could be a pretty high number, right? So the lower the loss tangent, the lower the dissipation factor. Again, those are exactly the same thing. Okay? So the dissipation factor is just, like I said, ESR divided by loss tangent. The Q, we talk about Q sometimes with resonant circuits and things like that, the quality factor, especially how sharp is a filter, for example, like an IF, a high Q IF filter, or a really narrow high Q filter will be at very steep sides, will be a very nice tight resonance. Okay, a low Q is going to be a little sloppier. What leads to that sloppiness is the ESR. Okay, 1 over the dissipation factor is the Q of a capacitor. Okay, again, all related. All right, they're all just different forms of measuring essentially the ratio of those two quantities. Now, as you might imagine, certain capacitors have got better ESR than others. Some certain capacitors will fail in a way where the ESR gets bad, gets high. Okay? So we'll talk a little bit about that. And that's one of the experiments we're going to run, and I should actually show you how to measure it. Because one of the pretty common failure modes, in a lot of modern electronics, is a failure of electrolytic capacitors that dry out, the ESR increases, the capacitors get hot, and they leak, or they go bad, or something like that, and it takes down the switching power supply, and all of a sudden your TV doesn't work anymore. It's a very, very common thing. So knowing how to measure ESR is a good way of testing capacitors when you're fixing something to say, okay, the ESR, this cap went bad because it dried out, and I need to buy you know, a better quality capacitor when I replace it so that the same thing doesn't happen again in a couple of years. So it is something, and there are people actually that sell ESR meters that specifically just measure ESR. Okay, a lot of them will claim to do in-circuit ESR measurements. I'm not a fan of doing any measurement of a component in-circuit because you never know how the surrounding circuitry is going to affect your measurement of that component. Right? You can't isolate that. So if you measure ESR, you don't know if the results are because that capacitor is bad or that something else around it is affecting it. Or is the capacitor really bad, but something else around it is making it look good? You really don't know. So you always want to lift the leg out and check the component all by itself. And you can certainly buy an ESR meter. I actually got a video that I did where I showed the ESR meter that I built about 10 or 15 years ago. Pretty simple, a couple of components, and you build one. I'm going to show you how to test it with, so we can visualize it on the oscilloscope. Okay? Everybody good? So a couple more properties. Something that we may not think about is that, well, capacitors will have issues with stability with temperature. Unlike, you know, resistors are reasonably stable with temperature. Other components that we use, transformers and things like that, are pretty stable with temperature. Sometimes not so with capacitors. They can vary pretty wildly with temperature in terms of their value. And it all depends on the properties of that dielectric. Some dielectrics are really good and stable with temperature. Some are not. Some will change in a nice linear fashion. Some won't. I mean, look at this curve right here. I got, you know, this capacitor here is a polymer. This is a tantalum polymer capacitor whose capacitance actually increases at high temperature. But look at this guy right here is a multi-layer chip capacitor with this dielectric called a Y5V that actually has got a maximum capacitance at around room temperature, but then degrades pretty wildly on either side of that. So lots of different capacitor types have different temperature characteristics, and they're not always linear. That capacitor is being used in, say, a tuned circuit or a VCO or an oscillator or a VFO, it might explain why things are drifting as it warms up or heats up or something like that or cools down. Okay. So also, this one kind of surprised me when I learned about it too, is that not all capacitors are stable with the applied voltage. Okay, you might say, well, okay, I kind of expected that, but I didn't expect this. You put a capacitor with, say, 1 volt across it, it'll read one capacitance value. You increase that to 2 volts, and the capacitance changes. Okay? And it's all because of the properties of the dielectric. And again, some are very, very stable with voltage variation. Some are pretty bad. Here's an example. This is a bunch of just different ceramic capacitors we're going to talk about here. There's a type called NP0, which is really stable with temperature or with voltage variation. But, and these X7Rs are not too bad, but look at that same Y5V crap that we looked at here. That one is really bad with voltage variation too. Electrolytic caps will actually vary with applied voltage. So an electrolytic filter cap on a power supply might go to, you know, 60 or 70% of its value when you're operating it at its normal operating temperature, or excuse me, operating voltage from the power supply, where if you measure it, it'll actually measure good, but it doesn't measure good when you measure it at voltage because of this property. So kind of a surprising thing, but it's also a reason why subcapacitors are chosen for a particular application. You say, why did the manufacturer use this? It's a lot more expensive than that cap. Why don't I just put this one in here? A lot of these are reasons why. Yeah.
Are silver micas naturally NPO?
Silver micas are based, they're not, their silver micas are not ceramic, so they're not really NPO, but they've got the properties of an NPO. Okay, NPO stands for negative, positive, zero.
Right.
Okay, which means that they don't have a positive or negative temperature coefficient. They've got a nice zero temperature coefficient and voltage coefficient. The silver micas are very similar to that. Absolutely. But good question. Now, something else that's kind of interesting is that some capacitors are microphonic, meaning if they vibrate, they'll produce a voltage or a current. So they kind of act like a microphone. Okay, some dielectrics, again, have this kind of piezoelectric type of property that they can actually convert vibration into voltage or current variation. They act like a microphone. That would be bad in some circuits, right? In some circuits, you may not care about it. Like if you're designing a VFO or a local oscillator or something like that, you put a microphonic capacitor in the radio, you turn the radio up, and all of a sudden you get this feedback of, you know, sound going back in through the LO. It could distort, you know, the radio and that type of a thing. So interesting thing. You don't think about that capacitor as a microphonic, but we talk about a condenser microphone, right? Condenser microphone is what? It's a capacitor, right? So, and where we're intentionally varying, you know, the plates to produce a voltage, well, there are a lot of capacitors that are unintentional microphones, okay? So let's talk about different applications for capacitors. I mean, there's a lot of different applications. And this is a pretty broad category of things, but it kind of shows, you know, our electrolytic, large value electrolytic capacitors, a lot of the different applications for those. Film capacitors, a lot of applications for those. Ceramic capacitors, a lot of applications for those. And you can see there's a lot of overlap. Well, again, for noise filtering or smoothing or blocking or decoupling, sometimes I could use any one of those. Okay, but for some applications like motor start capacitors and frequency converters, you might use one versus another. It really depends on the demands of that particular circuit and what properties you need that capacitor to have. Some of these other kind of esoteric properties besides just the capacitance, working voltage, and tolerance that really will affect the way that particular circuit will operate. And that's why there'll be one capacitor might be better or worse in some of these areas. So the one most common that we'll talk about are things like power supply filter. Okay, that's where we're going to stick a big capacitor on the output of a power supply to reduce the ripple that's coming out of the rectifier, that type of thing. Very, very common. These are typically very large value capacitors, mostly electrolytic or tantalums. For the most part, these are electrolytic capacitors of some sort, either aluminum or tantalum. Another application is DC blocking. And what I mean by DC blocking is I'm coupling two circuits. I've got a signal I've got to get from one to the other, but I don't want the DC from this circuit to get to this. I just want the signal to go through. Capacitors used in that DC blocking application. Okay. Another one is signal bypass. And this is in an amplifier, for example, you might have an amplifier structure where you've got a component that is a resistor is being used to set the bias, but you don't want it to affect the gain. So you put a capacitor around it so your signal goes around the resistor, but your DC goes through it. Okay, that's what we mean by a signal bypass. Okay. Tune circuits, another application for capacitors where capacitors are typically coupled with inductive components to make tuned circuits, resonant circuits for oscillators, filters, things like that. Timing circuits. Okay, we may use a capacitor to dump charge onto a capacitor, pull charge off a capacitor to set up a timer to do a particular job. Okay, a delayed start in an amplifier could be a number of different things. Okay. Another application is compensation, where you've got an amplifier or a circuit that is doing, that's got to operate over a wide frequency range. Its response might start rolling off somewhere. Sometimes capacitors are employed in certain parts of the circuit to kind of feed things back to flatten out a frequency response or something like that. We also talk about compensation when we talk about 10x probes on an oscilloscope. That's what we're doing is adjusting a capacitor to adjust the frequency response and compensate that probe for that particular scope. I've got a video on that, number 9. Just talking about that. I don't remember all 280 of them, but we were just talking about that one, so I didn't know it was number 9. So let's start off by talking about some of the various types of capacitors. Okay. So electrolytic capacitors, here's kind of what they look like inside. It basically is this wound up coil. It's kind of like our paper and wax capacitors, except that the dielectric is typically made of an electrolyte. So it's kind of more like a solution that's going around these conductors and things like that. But that's kind of typically what they look like. Sometimes they look like the paper caps, but if they got a polarity on them, oftentimes they are electrolytic caps, even though our paper film caps typically are not. You'll see some very large ones typically used in equipment, and also multi-section capacitors that are used in a lot of our radios. They're typically electrolytic capacitors. Values typically ranging from, say, a microfarad to even well over a farad. Typically, pretty common to have 40, 50, 100 microfarad caps for power supply applications for what we're doing. The working voltage, anywhere from smaller caps, might be as low as 5 volts, or what are called super caps, which are really just electrolytic capacitors designed to hold a lot of charge for like memory backup in modern devices. They might have a very low voltage rating, up to some reasonably large voltage rating, greater than 500 volts. The plate supply and things like that for some of our tube circuits. Okay. But most of them are polarized. Really all electrolytic caps are polarized, but you can get non-polarized electrolytic. What does that mean? Basically all they did is they constructed a capacitor, a polarized capacitor, and then they took another one of them and put it in series with it the other way around. Okay, so you essentially get a non-polarized capacitor. They typically are used in audio circuits, but not really common.
Speaker crossovers.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Doesn't that have an ESR though?
They will have, they certainly do have an ESR. Electrolytic capacitors, and that's one of the things about electrolytics, that the ESR
is a big problem. Right?
Yeah, so you're kind of working the other one kind of backwards. So one of them's kind of working kind of a leaky way, but it's in series with the other one. But it does certainly get a rise to ESR. Yeah.
What are the electrolytic motor storing capacitors? Are those nonpolar or are those?
There are oil filled.
Not the run, the plastic
Okay. Padded
electrolytics. The ones that'll explode if you try to use them as run capacitors.
Yeah. They're not AC rated. The oil filled ones are AC rated. The other ones are polarized. I do most of my work on microelectronics, but they are basically a form of just electrolytic capacitors, polarized caps.
Oh, they are polarized.
Yeah. And so what's the one that I've looked at are, but yeah. The self-resonant frequency we talked about, since these are relatively large capacitors with lots of little windings, there's a lot of series inductance associated with them. So the self-resonant frequency of electrolytic capacitors is typically not that great, typically well under 100 kilohertz. Okay. Well, for audio circuits, that's just fine. But for RF, it really isn't. Right? So sometimes some of the self-resonant frequencies of a large, like 1,000 microfarad capacitor might be 20 kilohertz, 15 kilohertz, something even less than that. Okay. But so that's one of the things that with an electrolytic, the SRF is pretty low. Most of them are these aluminum electrolytic. That's the most common, the least expensive versions that are out there. There's another one called tantalum we're going to talk about here in a moment. Okay. But this is kind of typical of what you'd see for electrolytic capacitors. They'll most, like I said, are polarized, so they're going to be labeled. For the most part, for aluminum electrolytic, the label is almost always on the negative side. There'll be a band on the body of the capacitor that almost always indicates the negative lead, okay, the lowest potential lead. Okay. This is kind of opposite of tantalum, where the positive lead is usually marked on the tantalums. So let's talk about the good and the bad for electrolytics. Okay, again, good, high volumetric efficiency. What I mean by that, you get a lot of capacitance and a small volume. Okay, a small, physically small capacitor can be a large capacitance. Okay, they're really good for power supply filtering, as I mentioned, because you have a lot, you filter out the 120 hertz or 60 hertz ripple out of a rectifier, whether it's a full bridge or a single half-wave rectifier. Okay, for power supplies and things like that. They're not too bad for medium or low frequency bypassing, bypassing the signals for like audio circuits and things. They'll typically work pretty well there, but certainly not for RF. Okay. Non-critical timing applications, they can certainly be used for where you don't really care. I got a timer that's got to be about this, this amount of time, it's not precise. They're okay for that. Again, because there's some problems with voltage sensitivity, temperature sensitivity, end soakage, all those things are some on the bad list here we'll go to. Energy storage applications. This is where you might be using if you think about the flash in a camera, you hear the whining coming up. We're basically dumping charge on a capacitor. Oftentimes, that's an electrolytic cap. We can store a lot of charge, so we have a lot of energy to dump through the flash tube. Okay. Also, low frequency interstage coupling. Right, we talked about coupling from one stage to another. If you're dealing with audio circuits and things like that, they generally could be used for that. Okay. What's the bad? Well, they do have a wear out mechanism. Okay, and typically as the temperature goes up, the capacitors heat up, the electrolyte will tend to dry out. So when it dries out, the ESR goes up. If the ESR goes up, then you're gonna dissipate more power because then the current going in and out is gonna basically go through that resistor, the effective resistance that's there, and dissipate power, heat up more. So it's kind of this vicious cycle that heats up and heats up and heats up and dries out, okay? So the ESR and temperature rising can be a bad thing and eventually lead to the demise of the capacitor and sometimes the circuit that it's being used in. Okay. We mentioned soakage and leakage. Again, the electrolytic capacitors are probably the worst in terms of, the worst type of capacitor in terms of soakage and leakage. So again, for critical timing circuits, that can be a real problem. Okay. They got relatively poor temperature performance. The leakage rises as the temperature goes up. Capacitance value changes and often goes down as the temperature goes up. So they're not really great over temperature, but that's just what they are. Okay. It's often why they're over-specced. If you ever look at an electrolytic capacitor tolerances, sometimes you'll see them, the rated -20 to +80%. Yeah, right? Well, why is that? Well, because if I got 100 microfarad capacitor, okay, I could tolerate it going down to 80 microfarad. I could tolerate it being more, but also I might overspec that cap because as the temperature goes up, it might drop down. Okay, so that's just, you know, kind of the way they are. You have to kind of account for that if you're designing something that's got to operate over a wide temperature.
Alan, a lot of our electrolytes would be stamped as 85 centigrade or 105 centigrade.
Yeah.
So you're saying the 85 centigrade is a lesser quality?
In terms of the how much the capacitance varies with temperature, it probably isn't going to be too much different between the two. Oh. In terms of the lifetime of the capacitor, okay, 105 degree cap running at 60 degrees will last longer than an 85 degree cap running at 60 degrees. Okay. So basically the capacitor's rated for higher temperature will last longer than an operating temperature compared to those rated for a lower.
Would it be a different dielectric?
I'm sorry?
Would it be a different dielectric or the mechanical?
It's probably a little bit of everything. It's probably a little bit of changes in the chemistry in the dielectric, changes in the physical construction, okay, to be able to dissipate heat and to retain the electrolyte and keep it from evaporating or drying out. So there's probably a number of things to do. And I didn't have a real design capacitors, but there's probably a number of things that really make one cap an 85 year cap, another one be 105 year cap.
I think some have studs on the bottom so that you can pull the heat out.
Yeah, intended for, you know, kind of more, you know, higher ripple current applications and things like that, yeah. Okay. And again, not really good for RF because of that low self-resonant frequency, okay? And then, as I mentioned, these have got pretty wide tolerances, right? So -20, +80 is pretty common, right? You can see that. And also, as I mentioned, they do have a fairly strong voltage dependency. Typically, the capacitors for electrolytic capacitors will drop as the applied voltage increases. Okay. So stuff they don't teach you. Right? So another type of electrolytic are the tantalum electrolytic capacitors, and it's just a bit of different chemistry. And as I mentioned, oftentimes the positive lead is often the one that's marked on the tantalum capacitors. And there's like dry slug, wet slug, things like that. But all the tantalums basically, again, they're similar values to the aluminum electrolytics, typically lower voltages. Okay, they're also, again, pretty volumetric efficient. They got they get a lot of capacitance on a small space, but they're typically for lower voltage applications. They got a better density, better volumetric efficiency, if you will, than an aluminum electrolytic. Okay, they typically have lower ESR, okay, which is a good thing. And pretty decent temperature stability. So we're basically improving on a lot of the things that where aluminum electrolytics, you know, kind of are deficient. What's the problem? Well, they cost a little more. Okay, and they also aren't available in really high voltages either. Okay. And they don't have the same dry out mechanism because the way they're constructed is a little bit different. Yeah?
It seems like a lot of tantalum capacitors, at least as I found them, when they get to be about 30 years old, very high incidence of shorts.
Yes, that's the big problem. One of the failure mechanisms when it does fail, instead of failing open, it fails short.
And they fail very dramatically.
They can be exciting. Yeah. they become, you know, smoke emitting capacitors or fire emitting capacitors.
So they can
get exciting when they fail. Electrolytics when they fail, so they can be moderately exciting, but tails when they fail typically are really exciting in a bad way. So again, good and bad, we'll talk a little bit about that. High capacitance density, we mentioned that. Good for power supply filtering, good for low and medium frequency bypassing. Non-critical timing, they're pretty good. Soakage isn't really so much of an issue on the tantalums, not as much. Good for energy storage apps. All the things that are electrolytic are pretty good for, interstage coupling. Really where the tantalums are good. The bad, they're really intolerant to reverse voltage. Okay, so in addition to wear out when they fail under normal conditions, don't put them in backwards. Right. They get excited. Okay. So, all right. They just don't like that. And they typically are not available for real high voltage applications, and they're costly. Okay, and not that great for RF. Yeah.
Have you ever wondered why, in the good old days, the electrolytics, the positive terminal was always marked? And then somehow, just to distinguish it from tantalums, it seems like in the last couple decades, now they mark the negative terminal.
Yeah, I don't really know why that is.
Yeah. increases your chances of putting them in back.
Yeah, right, yeah. Yeah, I don't know why that is. You always kind of protect it. I mean, hopefully, usually there's a stripe, and then there'll be a plus or a minus.
Right.
You know, so.
But in the good old days, it was always the positive.
Right? Yeah. I really don't have a good answer for why they do that.
See, the correspondence of some of the things in the introduction of the Oriental ones.
Hey!
So, all right.
Current is backwards.
We got current is really electrons going the other way. We've been backwards all along, so who knows? But anyway, sure, it has nothing to do with it. But just another thing that has to do with electrons. So, all right, so that's all kind of the electrolytic, high value, good for filtering type of capacitors. Let's start talking about ceramic caps. Okay. Most of the times the values are printed on them, most of the times with two digits and a multiplier, and that's all the value in picofarads. Okay. So in this case, a 104 would be essentially 100,000 picofarads, or in this case, 100 nanofarads, or 0.1 microfarad cap. Okay. So that's typically how they're marked. Values will range anywhere, again, from less than a picofarad to sometimes as high as 500 microfarads or more, and some pretty high voltage applications you can do with these caps, and high working voltages with ceramic caps. Okay. Now, this is where things get... We kind of splinter off into a lot of different things. The ceramic capacitors have got, the dielectrics can be broken down into a number of different classes, at least three. But the two that are most popular are class one, or kind of more the stable dielectric materials. They're indicated by terms for the dielectric called NP0 or COG. Okay, and these are the very ones that are very stable at temperature, they're very stable with voltage. But they've got a lower dielectric constant, so you're not going to get a large value of capacitance with an NPO cap. Okay. Or I should say NP0, to be specific. The class 2 dielectrics have got a higher dielectric constant, so in a given volume you get a higher value capacitor, but you pay the price for that, and the price is that they're going to start varying a bit more with supply voltage and temperature. Okay. So we'll talk about class 2s, and typically some of the more common class 2 dielectric types are given by these letters, X7R, Y5V, Z5U. I'll talk about what they mean, what that means, at least briefly. I'll show you what it is so you know what we're talking about. Okay. Any questions? Okay.
Those letters mean something.
They actually do mean something. Yes. We'll show you what they mean next slide. So don't fall asleep yet. So they're very low cost, okay? They're everywhere. And they're typically, you know, less than a penny in volume and things like that. They're just everywhere, extremely popular, and for good reasons. Okay, they've got very low ESR. Okay, so that's all good. All right, they're really good for RF applications, and they're really reliable. You rarely have to replace these capacitors. Okay, you see these disc capacitors in your equipment that could be in there 60 years and they're fine. They generally don't go bad. They don't have really, some very prevalent failure modes. Let's talk about the different classes. Let's start talking about the NP0 COG or class 1 dielectrics. These are typically, again, the relative dielectric constant is not as big, so the capacitor values aren't going to be very big. Typically less than a picofarad, and up to maybe a microfarad of capacitance is about the most you're going to get with an NP0 type cap, and even that would be a pretty low voltage cap. They're all available with some pretty tight tolerances, plus or minus 5% or 10% or even less, plus or minus 1%, that type of a thing, or you can get NP0 caps that way, okay? They're very stable with temperature and voltage, okay? Flat line, right, over a very wide temperature range, also a very wide voltage, operating voltage range, okay? So really good caps for that type of thing. And they're also really good for RF. They're generally very low ESR, very low series inductance, okay? So they are very, very prevalent in RF circuits. Okay, oscillators, things like that are a really good place to use NP0 capacitors. Another place very similar for like silver mic caps that you mentioned. Okay. So those are the NP0 COG class 1 ceramic caps. Unfortunately, you can't tell by looking at them. Is that an NP0? Is that a Y5V? You can't tell by looking at them. You have to kind of know when you buy it. You can't tell by just looking at them unless you kind of can tell by the context of the circuit they're in. But you can almost never go bad. If you can put an NP0 cap in wherever you're pulling one out to replace one, if you get an NP0 instead of whatever might have been in there, you can almost never go wrong. You just don't want to go the other way. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is that C0, G0,
or COG in the letter O?
There is a table. I think it's zero.
And what does that mean versus NP?
Well, let's talk about what it means for the class two. And there's a similar table for class one, because we only talk about these two and then bring the table up. But okay. Wiki,
gotcha.
If you do a wiki search on it, you'll actually find the table that kind of shows what all the letters mean. Okay? There's two different designations, like for different organizations, one that uses this NP0, one that uses the C0G, and there's two different tables of the different classes and how there are different types of dielectrics in that. But I didn't want to throw too much of the alphabet soup in there, because we can just talk about them and kind of group them all together. Okay. Well, let's talk about the class two dielectrics. Okay. So this is where you get into the alphabet soup. Okay. But those letters do mean something. Okay. And if you look at it, we talked about X7R. The first letter indicates the rated low temperature. So capacitors X7R, X5R, whatever, are rated to operate down to minus 55 C. The Y or Z prefix down to minus 30 or even just to plus 10 C. So we can see these Z capacitors are probably the really cheap ones. They're going to be in some of your really cheap consumer grade electronics. Okay. Better ones will have the Y or the better, even much better, the X-rated caps. So the next number, the number is the upper temperature. Okay, so an X7R capacitor is good from minus 55 C to plus 125 C. And then the R is the change in capacitance over temperature. Okay, so R is plus or minus 15% over temperature. So an X7R is minus 55 to plus 125, plus or minus 15% over that rating temperature range. Okay. The Y5V, which I said is a little bit worse, right? Doesn't go quite down as far in temperature. The 5 means I'm only going up to 85 instead of 125. And the V means plus 22%, minus 82%. Ooh. Really crappy tolerance.
Yeah.
Well, you think that's bad. Look at the Z5U. Right? That's even worse, right? Plus 10. Plus 85, plus 22, minus 82.
They better be cheap.
They're really cheap. Okay.
You see them a lot, though.
But the thing is, as you, why do you say, why do we have one? Again, as you kind of work your way down through these values, these different dielectric variations for class two, like the Z or Y rated materials, got a higher dielectric constant. So they're available in higher values for higher voltages. Whereas it might be difficult to get an X7R capacitor rated to 50 volts at whatever capacitance, but it's easier to get a Y5V or a Z5U rated for that voltage or that temperature because you get a higher dielectric constant. Okay. So to get that higher value capacitor than X7R, I need a thinner dielectric, and then you run issues with voltage. Right? So that's why there are different values, and again, you can't tell by looking at them, unfortunately. So it's, basically, I'd say you kind of work your way up this and get the best ones you can to put in your equipment. Yeah.
So it's probably safe to assume your $199 55-inch LCD TV is going to have the Z4V.
The good thing is these capacitors are typically not used in power supply filtering applications. Those are the electrolytics that dry out
Yeah. Those would be used in the tuner.
Yeah, there you go.
When you use the ceramic capacitor to decouple a digital circuit and power supply,
yeah.
Are those capacitors shorting out the high frequency noise generated by the digital circuit, or is it providing instantaneous power to the chip?
Yes and yes. Okay. And even another job.
Yeah.
And I actually did a video on this too. When you've got, say, a high-speed digital device that's driving a high-speed signal with some really fast edges going down off a line to another circuit, okay? As we all know, current flows in circles, right? So if I'm sourcing a signal down this transmission line or down a wire down to another circuit, there's an image current that's coming back, okay? That image current has to kind of get back to the power supply where it was sourced in the first place. So that's the job of these. You see a little ceramic cap next to every digital IC inside your modern electronics. A large part of what that's doing is providing that return path, so the image current is coming back to ground. Okay. So in that sense, it's kind of a little storage reservoir to supply the current in the first place, but it's getting replenished by the return path, the image current coming back. And so it really is all of those things. And plus this return path. So you might see a modern digital electronics that have got a couple of big bulk filter caps, because they're not handling the high frequency, they're handling the low frequency. They could be off in the corner of the board, but you've got sprinkled around these smaller ceramic caps all over the place to provide that local charge storage, that local image return current. Yeah.
And they also prevent the digital transient noise going into other nearby chips.
Right. Yeah. Again, by providing that local charge store, so it's not drawing it off the supply through the inductance of the supply rail, that type of thing.
And not annoying the neighbor chips.
Exactly right. Yeah. So if you didn't have that local charge storage, and you think all of a sudden this digital driver needs a bunch of current, it tries to pull that through the supply rail, which may have some inductance, right? And that means I'm going to bounce that power supply around, and anything else that's tied to it gets that bounce. Yeah.
Are these designed to fit those categories, or are they wind up there from a quality check?
No, it's basically just different variations of the ceramic materials that are used. So, so there's different classes, different designs. They didn't intentionally design the Z capacitors to be crappy. But what they did is they developed this dielectric material that had a higher dielectric constant to allow me to get larger value capacitors at a better working voltage. And they just happen to have these properties. The bottom line is you get nothing for free. Typically, as you work your way up in dielectric types to get a higher dielectric constant to get more volumetric efficiency, the price you pay is increased variations and things like that you get with power voltage and temperature.
Just as commercial caps are in a whole different price category than mill 390-14s or any other mill standard.
Yeah, there's a reliability testing that has to go on for those, qualification has to go on for those. Yep.
And you have to prove it.
Yes.
On a trail.
Yep. Okay. So again, the most popular ones I mentioned are these three that you'll kind of run across if you go to order caps from Mauser or DigiKey or something, or Jameco. Those are the most common ones you'll find. Again, if you're going to buy caps to replenish your stockpile and things like that, try to work your way up to the X7R or X5R type caps as opposed to the Y or Z materials with the V or the U and the final here. They're going to operate kind of a bit better. Now, in addition to these temperature ratings for these dielectric types, they're also going to have different voltage characteristics as well. And this is the curve I kind of showed you earlier here. Here's the voltage dependence. Remember, NP0 caps don't vary at all when operating over the rated voltage range. X7Rs will vary a little bit, maybe as much as 10% or 15%, and might drop down at the highest voltage. The Z5U, Y5V are pretty bad. Right, they could drop down to half their value at the rated voltage. Okay, and don't think about these things. So again, good reasons to kind of stay up here in the curve if you can. And the same thing with variation with temperatures. NPOs are great, or NP0s are great. X7Rs, not too bad. Z5U, Y5V, they're pretty horrible over temperature. So if you're operating that capacitor at near its rated voltage at a high temperature, that capacitor might have 20% of its rated value. So it's not the same value of cap you put in there, right? So these are the kind of things that they don't tell you until you're actually designing things, designing products. Like, oh wow, they're really crappy. Think about this.
So I got a drawer of hundreds of these things, and I recognize the numbers for the 104 as a 0.01, and the letters now mean something, but they almost never have a voltage on them.
They never have a voltage on them. They don't tell you what the dielectric type is.
Okay.
Right. So the only thing you can really do, if you can kind of match up, if you know the manufacturer, you might be able to kind of tell by that. If you've got a capacitance meter, to measure the capacitance of them, one of the things you can do is, and I've done this to kind of verify it myself, actually make some measurements of this, is I want to see how that capacitance changes with applied voltage. Well, you can't just apply voltage to it because now your capacitance meter is seeing the power supply that you're using. But if you attach a couple of resistors, like 10K resistors or something like that, 100K, to each end of the capacitor and bring that to your power supply, then you're going to isolate your power supply from the capacitance meter, so it's not going to see it so much. And then you can vary the bias on it. Okay. But you've got to be sure that the capacitance meter you're using is rated to measure charged capacitors. Okay. If it's not rated to measure charged capacitors, you can actually put another larger capacitor in series with the capacitor you're trying to measure. That will isolate the DC from your circuit or from the meter, but still allow you to apply a DC voltage. So it raises, and so you can actually apply a voltage to it and see how much is that capacitance is changing with voltage. You can decide, well, if it varies by close to 50%, it's one of these pieces of crap. Okay. Or it varies by only about 10%.
But as far as like the top working voltage, like how is those Wi-Fi V's cut off at 1,000 volts or something like that?
Again,
you just go down so far.
Sometimes tell from the size.
Right.
Right?
Okay.
You know, for a given size capacitor, the larger the capacitance, the lower the working voltage is going to be. You know, but you really can't tell.
Okay.
So you kind of have to, you know, look at what you typically have been seeing in the circuit you're using. Use something similar to it. If you just have a junk box set apart, but if you're pushing the limits of something, and this thing's operating at 50 volts, we have 50 volts across this cap normally, I'd probably go buy something new rather than pull something out of my junk box. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Is there a rule of thumb on the headroom between the rated working voltage and the voltage at which it'll fail?
Depends on how. Well, it's not the voltage that it'll fail. It's like, well, what am I going to put in there? If I'm always going to have, you know, 12 volts across this capacitor, what rated capacitor am I going to put in there? Okay. A good conservative, you know, reasonably conservative design would say I'm going to put a capacitor that's rated for twice that voltage. Okay. Because then I'm here on the curve instead of here, mm-hmm. right? So I'm not varying as much, okay, than I am if I'm operating close to the rated voltage.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not so much, for me, it's not so much how close am I to causing this thing to fail over time. I'm more worried about how much change I'm going to have, okay? But certainly you will accelerate the failure mechanisms by operating close to the rated voltage. But for ceramic caps, they're pretty reliable.
So the reason I ask is we tested some capacitors a couple years ago. We had some 4,000 volt caps, and we were trying to figure out if they would work at 6,000 volts, which seemed reasonable. And they did.
Yeah.
They ran all day at 6,000 volts.
Yeah.
At 7,000, they started to fail, and at 8,000, they pretty much all failed.
Yeah.
But we didn't check to see, so there might have been a whole bunch of other things going on.
Well, that plus, that 3,000 volt cap might have worked fine at 4,000 volts at room temperature. Mm-hmm. What happens when it heats up?
Mm-hmm.
So it's always dangerous when you start going beyond the rated values. Yeah.
This is another thing where back in the good old days, disc caps had their rated voltage and their temperature coefficients on.
Yeah.
You know, that disappeared too.
Yeah. Because people just, because they're so cheap, it's easier just to buy new than to kind of resalvage things. And, yeah.
If I'm using a aluminum electrolyte, I want, say it's rated 50 volts, and I put it in the circuit, it's only a 25 volt circuit.
Yeah.
Does the dielectric reform to the lower voltage and then preclude using it at the higher voltage again?
That's a good question. I'm not an expert on the reforming properties of the dielectric to know whether if you condition it at one voltage, does it not reform for the high voltage. I really don't know that for sure. Yeah, for the most part, again, operating at, you know, half of the rated voltage is always going to be a bit safer, you know, in terms of longevity for the cap. But I don't know about the reforming process actually.
Where do Teflon and glass capacitors fit in this picture?
We'll talk a little bit about Teflon. I'm not really mentioning, you know, glass capacitors a bit specialized, very expensive, very, very stable.
One cap.
It kind of gets into the porcelain caps, glass caps. They're very low loss, they're really good for RF applications or very, very high temperature applications. But again, pretty esoteric. You're not going to run across them in high voltage and an AFI radio.
In high voltage.
Yeah. All of these ceramic caps are going to have low ESR, so that's good. They are good for RF, okay, just like the NP0 caps are for RF, but I got a butt here, right? But they're microphonic. Mm-hmm. What I said about the microphonic, right? So here's where if I'm building a local oscillator or a VFO, if I can put an NP0 cap in there instead of a X7R or Y5V, I'd do it. But I can't go with X7R. I would never do it with a Wi-Fi video Z5D because they're going to vary way too much with temperature and voltage. Okay, things are going to drift you all over the place. And it's microphonic. Okay, so I use the NP0s or COGs for those types of applications. Okay, so well, saturated on ceramic caps capacitors now.
Okay.
So let's talk about film caps. Okay. Lots of different types of film caps. Many, many types of film caps. Okay. Are familiar brown drop and orange drop capacitors. You hear all the time. You know, the wax capacitors that we throw away piles of when we rip them out of radios. These are all different types of film caps. Okay. And they've got some pretty good characteristics. Generally, film caps have got some pretty tight tolerances. They're generally pretty low leakage, low absorption, low ESR or dissipation factor, and pretty stable with temperature and voltage. It's all really good news. Right? They're pretty good. And well, we use them oftentimes where ceramic caps, we can't get enough value in a ceramic cap, but we don't want to go jump to an electrolytic. So it really kind of fit that bill in between. But there's a lot of overlap between where you could use a ceramic cap or use a film cap. The problem is that the film caps are generally going to be a bit larger than the ceramic caps for a given value. So, you know, underneath the chassis of an old tube radio, who cares? But if you're building a small piece of compact electronics, a film cap just may not physically fit because they're typically pretty large with respect to like the ceramic caps. Okay. They're relatively good, relatively large in size, and they're really good from audio to RF. Okay, there's a couple of different types. There's metallized film. These will have the highest density, and they are somewhat self-healing because they get you know, arced or punched through. Sometimes they can actually heal themselves. They don't fail shorted, that type of a thing. The metal and metal foil and film, they're lower ESR, they're rated for higher currents. Typically, you won't know whether your cap is metallized film or metal and foil, but you know, it doesn't really matter. Okay, you just kind of choose that capacitor based on some other properties. Okay. So let's talk about some of the common types of film caps. Okay. So probably the most common is the polypropylene, PP. They're very popular with the orange drop, brown drop capacitors. The large majority of these are polypropylene, and it refers to the dielectric as this polypropylene. Okay. Very, very popular, low dissipation factor, low ESR, low absorption, really temperature stable. Okay, sometimes you find them in this form or kind of these little yellow round guys that look a lot like our old wax caps, but just kind of reborn. Another very popular one is polyester or mylar caps. Okay. And they're, again, they're not quite as stable with temperature and not quite as good as the polypropylene for DF and ESR, but they're lower cost. Unfortunately, sometimes they're available in the same package styles as the polypropylene, so you don't know which one you're getting. But again, they're all pretty good, so you wouldn't worry about it too much. Okay. Polystyrene caps. Polystyrene caps, very stable, very low DF, very low DA, they're pricey. Now, the thing with the polystyrene, they kind of look like this kind of translucent film. You got to be a little bit careful with these when you're handling them and soldering them, because you can permanently change the value by heating them up. Because the polystyrene is kind of a soft plastic, and if you spend too much time soldering them, it can kind of squish around and then stay there. The facets can actually change. You just got to be careful when you're actually using them, kind of solder them at the ends, or use your heat sinks or something like that when you're soldering them. Okay. But the Teflons kind of fall in this same category. Again, they're a bit pricier, and probably similar to polypropylene or polystyrene when it comes to performance.
With a higher temperature.
With a very higher temperature, yeah.
Now, the bumblebee, are they stable? Just guitar players.
Yeah, they're like the bumblebee, so that's the buzz or something. The bumblebee caps are basically just the same as our wax paper caps. So they're going to have the same failure mechanisms. They're sealed differently. They're not a cardboard tube sealed with wax. They're typically, you know,
they're paper.
But there's still a paper foil capacitor. Okay, it may be wax filled, but then closed in the plastic. Okay, but failure mechanism is the same. The paper ages. It goes acidic. It goes leaky.
Is that also true for bathtub caps from like surplus? You know, those cans, the capacitors which are cans and the oil filled
PCB.
Are those paper caps too?
I don't know the exact construction. I think the constructions will vary a lot on those. Yeah, when in doubt, replace them.
Right now. I mean, back in, they were used like before the war and the military.
That's before my time, so I don't. Which I don't have a lot of.
Additional experience, if they're oil filled, they're generally stable if you're not losing their oil.
Yeah. Probably pretty safe bet.
The problem with the bumblebee caps over time, it's like a Bakelite covering on them, and they do shrink.
Okay.
And they squeeze the
they could fail in an exciting way then.
Well, sometimes you find them where they've broken and the plastic has actually popped off.
It's actually a cracked line. But a lot of the capacitors that were paper, like in the radial 18s, okay. the power supply, they're still good.
Yeah.
So what gives? I mean, it was paper. And it's
yeah, I mean, if they're sealed up well enough, you know, that where you don't get any contaminants in there, you know, that's going to slow the acidic degradation of the paper, right? So.
I think there was a change in the whole paper manufacturing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know the dime novels from the 30s and they've all turned brown?
Right.
I think that's what they were using in the caps. Okay. And the so-called capacitor paper back in the teens and 20s is still white.
Yeah.
It was acid-free paper in the first place.
Okay. Yeah, so you know, so the bumblebee caps, you know, old wax caps, all kind of fall into these categories of film caps. And anything with the paper dielectric, you run the risk of that paper going acidic and causing leakage and problems in those caps. Okay?
Now they're polarized. They have a polaroid marking.
Yeah, it's a very interesting thing. So you oftentimes will see a marking on, especially the ones that are kind of wound up like this. They've got a marking, but they're not polarized. So what does that marking mean? Exactly right. So you're winding up essentially a foil and an insulator. You're winding them all up, and then one side, you actually have two layers of that. So one is the outside foil, the one that's on the outer wrap, and the one that's on the inner wrap. The marking is supposed to indicate the outer wrap. Because now what will happen is that when you use it in a circuit, you connect that outer wrap to the low impedance point of the circuit. Okay. Then that acts like a shield to keep RF and interference from getting into that cap. The problem is that these days, quality control, things like that, isn't what it used to be, and you will find caps that are marked incorrectly. Okay. But you can figure that out, actually. One of the things you can do is, if you have an old oscilloscope, just crank it up to the highest sensitivity you can get, clip your scope probe around the capacitor with ground, say, on the banded side and your probe on the other one, and start just grabbing the capacitor, things like that, and you'll see noise pop up on the scope. Turn the capacitor around and do it again. Whichever one gives you the least amount of noise, that's when you got the outer wrap attached to ground. Okay. So, and when you're working on a radio, the old caps are probably marked right. It's okay, that's where I want the banded end to be. When you go to put a new cap in there, verify if the banded end is really the outer foil before you put the cap in there. Get the least amount of noise and time and things like that in your radio.
What are AC line caps?
So they're typically used for so that a piece of equipment can meet its conductive emissions standard. Okay, so it doesn't inject a lot of crap onto the line. Okay, there's standards for that. There are caps that are specifically rated for line filter caps, but they are typically film caps. They're not polarized because they see both polarities. So they're typically there's a term for it, I can't remember, it's slipping my mind right now. There's a term for the cap is really for line filter like that. The terminology is escaping.
What is it? X and Y?
Yeah, one can go across the line and one goes from line to ground.
I never remember which one.
I forget which one's which. Spend too much time working on low voltage circuits.
They call them safety capacitors.
Yeah, exactly. They're safety capacitors because they're safety because if they fail, they don't fail in an exciting way.
Right.
Okay. But here's the trick question.
Yeah.
Why is that the case? Do you have any idea? I've asked around everywhere. Nobody can tell me why.
I think it's just the nature of the construction of the capacitor. What's going to wear out? What's going to fail?
Right.
Whereas a tantalum cap, chemically, okay, it's going to create a short. These things, if there's a short that gets created, it may burn itself and open up, so it doesn't create a dead, hard short.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it'll fail and then maybe essentially disconnect itself, kind of like a fuse.
Mm.
All right. So it's probably more something like that where a thing will fuse itself open, okay, or you know, the fuse blowing, as opposed to creating a dead, hard crowbar short. Okay, and it's probably a combination of construction and material selection and things like that that will ensure that that will happen, that it will fail in a way that it just goes, falls over. Yeah.
What would be the markings on the top yellow cap that would indicate ground, maybe?
Well, some of them are not marked at all. Usually, if they're marked, they'll have a band.
Just a band?
Just a band.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and also, if you see a band without a polarity, like a positive or a negative, and that probably tells you that that's supposed to be marked in the outer foil of a non-polarized capacitor. Okay, but again, you got to be suspect of it these days, unfortunately. Okay.
They mentioned the AC and wind caps.
Yeah.
Years ago, I had one fail, and okay. It was kind of funny because I was sitting in my living room, the receiver turned itself on.
Okay.
And a lot of the better audio equipment, they would put them across, basically across the switch, across power switch, across the line. So when you shut it off, you don't get a pop.
Yeah. Okay.
And it shorted. So basically, what it did was bypass the power switch.
Yeah. Right. Oh, okay.
And the receiver just warmed up and won.
Okay.
It was a modern capacitor.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Well, quality control isn't today what it used to be.
Yeah.
There's capacitors that are filmed like that are rated with only an AC voltage instead of a DC voltage. Are they the same thing as those XY caps?
Good question.
Because I've seen, like, you know, like 4 microfarad film caps, but they're like 150 AC or
Sometimes you'll see rated for AC because you can do some construction techniques to ensure that AC operation is going to be okay, rated for AC. So basically, all caps are rated for DC. An AC rating just means it's tested under AC conditions as well and rated for that.
Okay.
All right. So another popular one in RF circuits is going to be the mica caps. And they look a little bit like the film caps in terms of the way they're constructed. They look kind of like this molded thing. The way you can discern them is they're kind of lumpy.
Yeah.
Okay. They kind of have this kind of lumpy, kind of molded structure as opposed to kind of a smooth, you know, overlaid type envelope. Okay. But then you all got the old mica caps, which are, you know, the old domino caps, where you got the colored dots to indicate the values. Those are also mica caps, and they're called dominoes oftentimes. The mica dielectric, really good in terms of for voltage and things like that, kind of like glass and that kind of thing. But the dielectric constant isn't this high, okay? So if, you're not going to get very large values in a mica cap, okay? But you will get some very high working voltages. They're really stable with power, with temperature and voltage, really tight tolerances, excellent for RF performance. Okay, kind of like NP0 caps, even better than NP0 caps, actually, better than ceramics, lower loss, things like that, lower loss tangents, et cetera. So typically used in things like VCOs, oscillators, filters, tuning circuits, those types of things. Okay, and also very reliable. Even these domino caps that might be 60, 70 years old, you rarely have to replace them.
So over time, the dominoes are very reliable.
Yep. Yeah, ceramics are reliable. The dominoes are reliable. Films, depending on the structure, you know, the older paper wax, you know, caps are not so good. But the other films are actually really reliable too. Yeah.
The word on the street is that people are starting to see on the internet. People are reporting starting to see failures in some of the old mica caps. Anybody had any experience with that here?
You get like a solar migration or something like that, yeah.
Well, I don't know, but some of them do fail in some applications, so I guess it's by manufacturer or whatever.
Yeah.
I'd seen that 20 years ago starting to happen.
Yeah, oftentimes you get the plating, the metallization is used on them is silver, so I don't think called silver mica caps.
And there's probably issues with this bakelite compound or whatever it is that they're in. But, you know, my when I'm talking to people about restoring a radio, you want to get all those paper caps out of there.
Yeah.
Try not to replace the mica caps. A lot of them are frequency determining circuits. And then
they've been selected in tests.
But be aware that sometimes they do fail. They get leaky. And so you may have a strange situation.
Yeah.
On the leftmost single domino, there's an arrow in between the dots.
Yeah.
What does the arrow indicate?
It's kind of the way to hold it to read the value.
Oh. Yeah, the pin one.
So, what, do I start here and read the color code that way, or do I start here and read the color code that way?
Okay, how do you read that guy?
I think you kind of have the arrow facing that way, and you start here. So this would be red, white. Okay, so two.
Counterclockwise.
Right, yeah, and then you kind of go two values and multiplier, then it's like a voltage rating and that kind of thing. Yeah.
Also, the
least one company called Micro Molding paper caps that looked like those, but they're not.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
that's okay. Cool.
Wow. Yep. That is cool. Yeah.
So it seems like easy to tell.
When you find a 0.1 micro cap, it's paper, replace it. Yeah. It's already there.
Even though it kind of looks like that,
yeah,
it's
yeah,
not.
Bigger. Okay. Good enough. Yeah.
Any advice on how to tell the voltage rating on the RC dipped micros?
If they're rated, it'll be kind of the second row of dots.
No, I mean the epoxy dip.
Oh, the epoxy ones, if they're not marked? It's hard to say. It can kind of judge it by size, but not always.
Yeah.
But for a given value, a physically larger one compared to another one of the same capacitance value, that will probably be the higher voltage one. But without a point of reference, it's very difficult.
Blue, no, then 60% of that, 40% of that.
Mark them and put them in a bag with a better mark. You know. But if you're salvaging them, you got a bag full of them you picked up at a hand fest, it's like, well,
exactly.
Yeah. You don't know. But the good thing is that a lot of them are rated, they're not like 5 volt or 10 volt caps, are typically 50 or 100 or more. But if you're using it in a circuit where you've got 100 volts on, it's like, well, is it really okay?
Is there any minimum that you don't find below 50?
I don't know. I'm sure there is, most of these kind of like molded ones that I've seen are 50 volts or higher, at least the ones that I've seen, but they're probably a lower one. Unfortunately, if they're not marked, it's one of those things you can't tell the dielectric type, you can't tell the working voltage if it's not marked off the top. I mean, it'd be pretty safe if it's a pretty big cap, it's not going to be 5 volts. So. But it's pretty close to case. So a couple more types of caps. We all know those. We talk a lot about our old wax, foil, and paper caps, and they're basically the early film type capacitors. Oil filled caps, we kind of talked about these already. Typically, for high voltage, industrial applications, AC rated applications, things like that. Porcelain caps kind of fall in the same category as glass caps, things like that. A bit esoteric, really for those really demanding, ultra-stable, high-frequency, microwavy type of RF type applications. You're not going to typically run across them, but it's just another type that's in there. I didn't put glass caps in here, but you could probably list as many unusual types of caps as the popular ones that we've kind of talked about already. But just you'll see different types. And it's all based on the dielectric, right? Everything was about the dielectric. The dielectric determines the working voltage, the ESR, the loss, the leakage, the reliability, the voltage, how it's going to vary with temperature, power, and voltage. All of these things are determined by the dielectric type, and that's why there's all these different types. Okay. And of course, there are adjustable and variable caps. Lots of different types. There's little trimmers and things like that to adjust, one-time kind of tuning of things. Things like polyvaricons and bread slicers are typically used in things like tuning circuits and that type of thing. Other trimmers that might be used to kind of set the range of tuned circuits and IFs and things like that. But lots of applications with VCOs, VFOs, tuners, trimmers, filters, etc. Lots of applications where we might have to tweak or tune a particular capacitance value or tune something in. Yeah.
Could you explain what a butterfly cap is?
So a butterfly cap is actually kind of what these guys are right here. Typically what it is two plates separated by a screw. That usually goes into a block of ceramic or something, and there's usually like a mica insulator in there. And it's kind of like almost a little bit of a spring type of a thing.
That's a compression cap.
Yeah.
He's talking about these butterfly caps that have set of plates like that, a set of plates like this, and then over here you have two more sets of plates.
Okay.
So it's a dual cap.
Okay. I guess I've always been thinking about it this way. So,
right.
Yeah,
there's also differential caps.
Okay.
You have two plates and a rotor that will.
Well, I mean, oftentimes when you see a different shape to the plates.
Well,
that's going to determine how the capacitance varies as you rotate it, linear or nonlinear.
Right.
But I guess I'm not as.
I'm referring to, they say you use butterfly cap when you tune the lumen cap.
That's because it's balanced to ground.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. There's something new over here. Okay. All right. So, now it's lab time. Okay. We're going to go measure a couple of things. And the two things we'll go do is to show you one way to measure unknown capacitors using a scope, because I'm a scope jockey. I do everything with a scope that I can possibly do with a scope. So we'll talk. I'll show you one quick way of measuring unknown capacitors with a scope. And need a couple of other things besides just the scope, but we'll talk about that. And we'll also talk about measuring ESR, visualizing with a scope. Because these are the two things we're going to do. I did videos on both of these things. So these pages that you've got here are the same notes that are on my video. So that's why it's always handwritten things. I just took copies of that rather than retype all this into the slide. So what we're going to do to measure a capacitor is just kind of take a look at a simple RC circuit. Okay, and I built that up on my little breadboard here. And what we'll do is we'll apply a square wave to it. Now, the scope has got a built-in signal generator, so I didn't have to bring a signal generator with me. But you could buy a cheap little function generator for $15 off of eBay these days if you don't have something that could generate a square wave, or build a little circuit with a 555 timer IC. Or can I say IC in this
room? Of course!
And
you differentiate.
So a 555 that came out in 68, so that's still old enough to qualify. Yeah, right. Okay. So anything to generate, a square wave. Okay. And square wave of about a kilohertz or so work just fine.
So your scope would generate that.
Yeah, so even the scope calibrator can be used sometimes depending on the output impedance of that. So what we're gonna do is apply a square wave to a known series resistor. In this case I've got a 1K ohm resistor built in on my fixture. And we're applying that to my unknown capacitor. Now, if you know anything about it, it's an RC circuit, it's going to have the voltage that's going to appear across the capacitor is going to vary in this kind of exponential way, right? So we apply this input voltage to the input of the resistor, and the voltage on the capacitor charges up, and eventually, after about 5 RC time constants, right? Take the resistance times the capacitor. After about 5 RC time constants, you kind of reach like 99% of the value, right? The key we're going to exploit here is that in one RC time constant, literally take just the product of these two values, in one RC time constant, we rise up to 63% of the value. It's like, well, that's not a very convenient number. It turns out it really is when it comes to measuring. Okay, it comes from this equation. We're not going to bother talking about the equation. But what we're going to do is take advantage of that on the scope. Okay, let's see. So what we're going to do, if we look at the scope, if we adjust this amplitude of this waveform on the scope by adjusting the vertical sensitivity of the scope, so that the waveform goes up 8 divisions between, so we got all these divisions on the scope here, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So this one happens to be 8 divisions full screen. If we make the voltage go up a full 8 divisions, it turns out that 63% of 8 is 5. Okay. So what we do is we just take a look at the waveform and say, how long does it take to rise 5 divisions out of 8? We measure that. Now I know the time, right? That time is T. And I know R, I solve for C. That's really easy. Let's go look at that. Okay. So I got the scope screen up here.
All right.
Oh, I got to get my glasses. Scope screens are getting smaller. My eyes are getting worse. So here we go.
I want a chair, Alan.
No, I'm good. No, I got to get down here and play. So the scope happens to have a little square wave generator on it. Okay, so if I take my unknown capacitor out of here, for example, let me pull it out of here, and let me go measure my... So I can actually see my square wave there, right? See the bottom along the bottom that's going up to the top here? Now what I want to do is adjust that so that it's right at full screen. So I'm going to go to my fine scale here. And if I start adjusting that down here, I want to get that waveform. So right now, the bottom of it is already right at the bottom of the screen, or pretty close to it. And let me go back up to that again. And let's adjust this up until I get right to the top of the screen. So now I've got basically 8 divisions for my full scale. All right, let me clear off that menu.
What's the source impedance of the generator?
Great question. So the generator in this case is 50 ohms.
50 ohms.
Okay, so I'm driving into a 1K, so the 50 is kind of negligible at this point. Okay, but we're going to worry about that on the next experiment. Okay, but for this one, you don't have to worry about it so much. Okay, unless you have to make this resistor small to measure some large value capacitors, then it starts to matter. So I've got a little capacitor in my hands right here. If I take this capacitor and stick it in my little test fixture here. All right, there we go, right? Now, Of course, on your old analog scopes, you may have to go and count divisions, right? Count divisions vertically to 5, work your way down, count your divisions, how long it takes. Here we can take advantage of cursors, right? So I can move one cursor here to right where that voltage is just starting to rise up. And then I can cheat over here. I'm cheating, but hey. So I will. So now if I move that to, so I'm crossing now here at 5 divisions here versus 1. So I went up 5 divisions. I can see it took 1.05 microseconds. Okay, so it took basically 1 microsecond to go that 63%. And I got a 1K resistor. So if I took 1 microsecond divided by 1K, that will tell me I've got a 1 nanofarad capacitor. Okay, and you look at the capacitor value, hey, it says 1N on it. It's a 1 nanofarad capacitor. Okay, so you can go build yourself a little oscillator out of a 555 or a little microcontroller. You can play with those things, or sometimes even use the scope calibrator signal. Okay, but you don't really know what the output impedance of that is. Okay, and very easily measure the capacitor values. Okay, pretty simple. You might have to build a fixture that you can vary the resistance. Okay, because the 1K may work well for a certain range of capacitors. You might need something larger or smaller for very small or very large capacitors. Okay. And if you get to really small capacitors, you might have to worry about the capacitance of the probe, okay? Because the probe input capacitance might be 10 or 15 picofarads. So you're trying to measure a 15 picofarad capacitor. It's going to double that value because that's appearing in parallel with the capacitor. Okay. But it's a simple little way of measuring things, and it's a lot more fun than just plugging into a meter and reading a value. It's fun to me. Okay. All right. So let's talk a little about ESR. Okay. So now ESR, we are going to think about the output impedance of the function generator. In this case, that function generator basically is a ideal voltage source, can be modeled with a 50 ohm series resistor, which means it has a 50 ohm output impedance like most signal generators have. And remember, the ESR of a capacitor is we're looking for that resistor value, effective resistor value there. Now in this case, we want to generate a signal that at a high enough frequency that for the capacitors where we care about ESR, and this is typically electrolytic capacitors, typically greater than a couple of microfarads, is really the only place we're going to ever measure ESR. That's the things that we're failing and we're going to go measure. So 200 kilohertz is a high enough frequency that the capacitive reactance of most of these electrolytic caps we're looking for will have well under 1 ohm of capacitive reactance. Right? So you should ideally see is just some very small leftover series resistance, we go make a measurement. So we want it to be low enough to be able to ignore any transmission line effects. We don't want to test with 10 megahertz or 100 megahertz, because then we got to start worrying about all kinds of RF effects. But anything lower than this, then we might not be low enough XC, or capacitive reactance, to make it work. So that's a pretty decent little sweet spot. In fact, most ESR, commercial ESR meters, will typically test the capacitor between 100 and 200 kilohertz or so as a test frequency. Because for electrolytic caps, that's a good sweet spot. Without getting into the RF crap and without having to deal with too low a frequency. 1 volt peak to peak is a pretty good number. You can use larger caps, it's all good for out of circuit. If you really want to test something in circuit, but again, I don't like doing it, 200 or 300 millivolts will work because that'll kind of at least keep the diode junctions and things from turning on the semiconductor devices. Okay, but as I said, testing in circuit is always a little bit suspect. Okay. So what's our process here? So first thing we do is we measure what essentially the open circuit voltage of that function generator is. When you're basically loading it into a high impedance or an open circuit, let's measure what that open circuit is. Okay, we need to know that function generator voltage. Okay, so we just directly probe across and actually measure that. So keep that number ahead or adjust it to a known value, like a volt peak to peak or something like that. And what we're going to do is basically attach our capacitor to be tested right across there. Now, if the capacitor had ideal zero ESR, right, then we're just going to basically see this capacitor be pretty darn close to a short, right? At 200 kilohertz, the X sub C might be well under an ohm. That'll look pretty darn close to a short, so the voltage we look at with the scope will be really, really small. The reality is that ESR is going to be some non-zero value. We'll see some residual square wave through the ESR, okay? So let's actually look at our setup. Okay, so here's our setup. We're basically just going to connect up the function generator, put our little, I got a little test fixture that I can put my RNC in here, okay? And then ideally what you may see is some just residual little bit of a square wave from our 1 volt peak square wave. And then the magnitude of what we're left with there is the voltage across that series resistor, or the ESR. And you can kind of go through the math, but this is the equation where you can actually calculate out what the equivalent series resistance is. Just the voltage across that resistor times 50, because that's where the 50 comes from here, divided by the difference in voltage between the open circuit voltage and your measured voltage. Okay, it's a pretty simple thing. Now, when these capacitors fail, oftentimes the ESR goes up, and the capacitance value goes way down. So what happens if the capacitance value goes way down? The X sub C, the capacitive reactance, is not as low as you wanted it to be. And what you'll see oftentimes on the screen is that. You're going to see a fast transition up or down due to the R, and then the slow exponential ramp from the capacitor. Okay, if the capacitor is large enough, this guy is basically so slow that it looks flat on the screen. So let's look at a good and bad one. Yeah.
Okay. I'm struggling to follow you on one point here.
Sure.
On the when you're measuring the equivalent series resistance, How do you differentiate between that or the bad part of that between what you would normally expect to see as that tiny residual reactance of the cap, of an ideal cap in there, or is the equivalent series resistance include that?
Well, yeah, so it includes that. So the reality is that no capacitor is going to have zero ESR.
Mm-hmm.
So you're always going to get some residual little square wave.
Mm-hmm.
And the question is, how big is it? How big is this voltage we're measuring across this device?
Mm-hmm.
And what does that calculate out to a particular an ESR value?
But what's the difference between the ESR of an ideal or of a good cap, the best possible cap, and when
and
it starts to get into a failure mode?
So it's a good question. For the most part, for most of the caps you find in switching power supplies and modern electronics and things like that, the ESR is typically an ohm or less. Maybe a half an ohm, maybe three quarters of an ohm, maybe an ohm and a half of the smaller value caps, or you know, actually very large value caps because you have a lot of foil in them, when you think about it. But there isn't a magic number. But when things fail, then you start looking more like 5 ohms, 10 ohms, or more.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Plus, oftentimes if the caps dry out, you see a reduction in capacitance. And you'll see where you should see something that's flat on these edges is not. Okay. In fact, a lot of the ESR meters that you get actually measure this total peak-to-peak voltage, and they don't really discern between when the capacitance value has dropped to 10% of its value, or the ESR has risen, or both. It just reports that as all as ESR. But in either case, it's all bad, right? So it doesn't matter. It's still a go-no-go type of test, right?
Bad plus bad.
Right, yeah, there you go. Bad plus bad is worse. Yeah, you could certainly do the test we just did to measure the capacitance, right? You can measure the capacitor first if you wanted to do it that way, but this is the way of looking at ESR. Okay, so let's actually go look at that. Let's switch over here. All right. And so let me, I'm going to do a little, to save myself a bunch of button pushing, I'm just going to load up a setup here. And move my signal generator down here. And I've got a, see if I pull, let's pull this capacitor out right now and just go measure what we're looking at here. So there's my square wave coming out of my signal generator right now, right? Looks pretty good. So so that's about a 1 volt peak to peak square wave. One thing you want to do on the scope when you do this is that the capacitor is going to average out that voltage. So the DC voltage is going to sit about half the peak to peak value. In order to measure that small variation on that, the easiest thing to do is on the scope itself is set it to AC coupling. Okay, that way it'll remove that DC content in the scope, and you can really zoom in around that to go see what's going on. Okay, so I've got a 220 microfarad capacitor in my hands here, and let me go stick that thing in my little fixture, which is just putting the capacitor, kind of shorting out that. So you can see we basically averaged, we basically dropped that signal all the way out. All I got is these little blips at the transitions, right? Those little blips are the high frequency edges. Okay, they've got a lot of high frequency content, so the inductance of the leads and my test fixture are going to cause those little blips. But what we're really interested in is what that peak-to-peak voltage variation is. And if I increase the sensitivity of the scope here, so now I'm at 10 millivolts of division. Now I can actually see, so I've got 10 millivolts, say, from here to here. So I'm at about 6 millivolts of residual square wave left from that 1 volt square wave. And I can flow that into this equation. And I think they did that and winds up being something under 1 ohm. Okay? Let's bring this kind of back up here again, about where we had it there. Let's go grab a capacitor that I pulled out of a computer monitor about a year ago, okay, that had failed. And we stick that guy in the same little fixture here. Let's get in there. Now, on this scale, I could barely see any voltage variation on the good cap. You know, here, the scope is at 200 millivolts of division. I've got, you know, probably 180 millivolts of variation here. And if I zoom in on that, so we can actually see this kind of straight part here is due to the ESR, and then the kind of exponential part is due to the loss of the lower capacitance value. Okay, but pretty easy to see that I didn't completely kill my square wave. Okay, so this cap is bad. Other good caps, but just different sizes, will also behave differently. Let's bring this guy back down here again. Now, look at this capacitor here. Here's a 100 microfarad capacitor. Let's compare that to the 220 microfarad cap. It's only half the value, but it's a whole lot smaller. Generally, the smaller physical embodiment of a capacitor means it's going to generally have higher resistance, higher ESR. And that's probably going to be the case here. Let's look at this guy. Circuit there. So if we zoom in on that guy, so now I'm at that same 10 millivolts of division that I looked at with that 220 microfarad cap. You know, and I've got probably close to 20 millivolts here. Okay, so the ESR here is probably closer to about an ohm or so, but still not bad. Okay, once you get to several ohms and things like that is generally when the ESR is the point where you want to yank that cap out of there. Okay. But pretty simple thing. All you need to get is a square wave generator. In this case, about 200 kilohertz is a good number. Again, microcontroller, 555 timer, cheap little function generator from eBay or Amazon for $12 or something like that would work just fine for this. If you don't know what the equivalent output resistance is, there's ways of measuring that, or you could physically put a resistor in series so you know what it is. Okay. So then that would just change the way you calculate out the ESR. Okay. So that's what we had. Hopefully, you want to come up and take a look at the fixtures I built. I just kind of threw them together for doing the videos that I did on the topic, but anybody can throw something together like that. While I'm using a modern digital scope, you can do this with just about any trigger scope that you might have available to you.
I would take the scope.
Yeah, so
I've been there.
I work for Tektronix, so it didn't cost me anything for this. It's a Tektronix scope. But this particular scope model ranges from a couple of $1,000s to $15,000 or $20,000, depending on how you operate. So it's an expensive scope.
It helps.
But you can do this with what you find at the But I couldn't plug a VGA projector or a VGA output into one of those old scopes.
My $50 USB scope.
So,
You don't even get the back
app. That's
so,
right.
Any other questions? Yeah.
I assume R is precision resistor to keep everything nice and.
This R here?
Yeah.
This R here is actually part of the output, part of the function generator design. Okay.
The other R you're showing there is the series resistance.
This R is the equivalent series resistance, the equivalent model of that series resistor of the capacitor. Yeah. It's not a physical resistor, it's just that distributed resistance through the body of the cap.
While we're here, can you just tell us really quickly, if you don't know what the impedance in your signal generator is, how to figure that out, because I think I know how to do that, but I wouldn't bet the bank on it.
Yeah, so there's a video on that.
Okay.
But and I don't remember the number, but we can search it and take a look.
Okay.
So basically what we do is we, the process is you hook up, one way to do it, an easy way to do it, is measure the open circuit voltage. Then put resistors, variable resistors on the output until the voltage drops in half.
In half, okay.
And then whatever that resistance is equal to the output resistance.
Half power.
And that works well except for circuits that have got a really low output impedance. Then it might not be able to drive that really low impedance that you're driving. But in most cases, the function generators are going to have, the ones that go up to reasonably high frequencies will have a 50 ohm output impedance, or sometimes even less. Ideally, they have 50 because then they're going to be impedance matched. You don't get the reflections and that type of thing. But these really cheapy ones you get off of eBay that come out of who knows where may not be 50, but it's worth checking them. But then some older signal generators that might have been used for some old audio gear might have a 600 ohm output impedance, not a 50 ohm output impedance. Hmm. But again, that kind of a test is an easy way to do it. Anything that's got a 50 ohm output impedance, you drive 50 ohms pretty easily. So I would say connect to 50 ohms. If your voltage drops in half, you know it's 50, you're done. If it doesn't drop in half or drops to another value, you could search resistor values, but there is a way of computing what that is just based on what the drop is. You go from open circuit to something else. And that the details of that are, it's a little bit longer equation, but you can calculate out what that is with a known resistor load. Okay, good questions. Yeah?
Can you say something about supercapacitors? That's a new capacitor that we're coming up with.
Sure. A supercapacitor, really, the way I look at it, is really nothing more than a very highly volumetric efficient electrolytic cap. They're polarized. So electrolytic cap, typically designed with very, very thin layers, so they can wind a lot of them on there to get very high capacitance, a farad sometimes or more. But because the effective foil or conductors is so thin, and the dielectric is so thin, the rated for very low voltages, typically 5 volts or something like that. So they're typically used for battery backup and for memory backup and things like that.
They want to use it like for cars that you can charge up very tip packs.
Yeah, the problem is that because they're really thin, a lot of times they're not rated to have very high inrush or outrush current. You have to be careful about how quickly you charge them or discharge them. So you really can't start a car with them unless you get ones that are rated for that. But it really comes down to the construction of the metallized layers really determines how much current you can push in and out of these things, how quickly you can charge them or discharge them. But the reality is a supercap is just a very high volumetric efficient electrolytic. Any other questions?
Awesome.
Thank you very much. And we're going to
Notice I just said every year.
Every year.
Yeah. What are you going to do for an encore?
Thank you so very much. Okay, we have a little auction out front, so please come out and join us, and we'll put it to sleep as quickly as possible.
Oh, that was the proverbial drinking from the fire hose.
What'd you say?
I said, that's the proverbial drinking from the fire hose. Yeah, that's a lot of stuff.
Thank you. I'm sorry if I asked you any questions.
No, no, no.
That's a nice book.
How are you doing? What do you use for a neutral density filter? You have a variable neutral density filter fader?
I don't. I used to have them in my older cameras, but the
is it built in?
There's no neutral. I have external neutral density filters that I can put on the lens, but I hardly ever need them because the range of the sensors and the controls in here, you can shoot from almost total darkness to brilliant sunlight.
Right, but don't you want to? Yes, don't you for cinematic? Don't you want to shoot at 24?
That's when I want to get very hot, very open. When I want to get the lens open in bright sunlight, that's when I will put it.
Well, that's what I'm asking.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah, that's an adapter that I have to screw onto the front.
Is it variable, or do you have to put in different?
I have a handful, two, three or four different different.
Because I'm having problems with the variable neutral density. Are you familiar with the Maltese cross problem? Very wide angle.
No.
And you stop it down.
This is with the variable.
With the variable.
I've never
it's two
used
polarizers.
The only. Oh yeah. Well, I've used the variable polarizing filter, but I use that to eliminate spectral reflections.
No. This is just for This is you take two. You take a linear polarizer and a circular polarizer, and you sandwich it, and then you can vary it.
Yeah, no, never played with that, not once in my whole life.
Because, you know, you get this artifact.
Yeah.
This
I think I've heard of it, but I've never...
I'm trying to figure out the physics of that. It's complicated.
Well, I would say the easiest thing to do is don't use a variable filter and, you know...
Yeah, I know. Because, you know, the landscape people, like, they might want to have a 10-stop reduction so they get the nice smooth water or waterfalls and or, you know, very shallow depth of field.
Yeah. But what I do normally, I'll tell you my secret. You know, they say the secret to success is to surround yourself with the smart people. In my case, that's very easy to do. Everybody's smarter than me. When I need to get cinematic, I bring in friends of mine that have much better, much more expensive cameras, and we use their cameras then. This one can do it, but you know, again, if I'm going to be that fancy, I usually have a larger crew and I have more equipment. And in situations like this, I'm just trying to keep the guy in frame and in focus, and we don't worry about getting...
No. I mean, you got some good stuff, like this tripod here.
Well,
I saw it used for like 1500 and head for like $2,000.
Yeah,
and the case you carry it in is
You know what the problem with this head is?
What?
This head is too big for this camera. This camera is not heavy enough to load that head properly. That head will hold a big camera and a teleprompter, and I keep the head partly because it's a very good head, and I can use a teleprompter with this camera with this head.
Okay.
But when I don't have a teleprompter on here, I've had to resort to hanging a bag full of batteries off the front of the lens here to balance the camera. It's too big for the tripod.
You can't get smooth motion unless you have
it won't balance.
It won't balance.
It won't balance. The head is a 50. It'll balance a 50-pound load. And this camera weighs 3 pounds. It's it doesn't load it enough to make it operate properly. And that is a bit of a problem.
Oh, okay.
But
your talk last week, I watched it at home. I mean, you are an amazing guy. You're the pinball guy and all that other stuff.
Oh,
I mean, you have so many hobbies, just like me.
That's what I need to have 12 step programs in order to control my
hobbies.